So this is this was what my boss, Michael Bloomberg, was constantly telling us. Anytime that we're trying to pitch him on an idea or get his support for a policy, you know, it's like, yeah, where are the charts? And then it was terror for anybody who brought a chart because he would like pick it apart, right? And so he'd be like ripping it apart, and before you know it, in 5 minutes, you realize he was right and you were wrong, even though you're the expert. So he's kind of a tough guy to work for, but very inspiring because he does believe in evidence and science and grounding your vision and your passion in the facts of what you're working on. And so great discipline as far as that is concerned. So let me tell you who I am. Before I go and talk, I'm going to talk a little bit about our reforms in juvenile justice in New York City. The last 8 years, the second and third term of the Bloomberg administration, I was the deputy mayor for health and human services. First term, I was the commissioner for homeless services. And I was just thrilled when, the mayor didn't ask me, I asked him if I could have the job, and he said yes. And I was just thrilled when he gave it to me. The goal that I had very much in moving from homeless services, before that I had been in child welfare work in New York City as a deputy commissioner, but the goal in moving to City Hall was really to help all of the commissioners that I worked with, the health agencies, the human service agencies, and the justice agencies, corrections, probation, and juvenile justice. The goal was to help those agencies to work together more collaboratively around their shared goals. And having been in two different agencies, I knew that agencies could be very expert in their the core mission of their agencies, but it was really, really hard to work across agency lines and to find ways to address the core problems. But that's what people wanted to do. They didn't want to address the crisis that was getting the client in front of them. What they were really interested in is working in a more preventive fashion, going further upstream and getting underneath some of the causes of the crisis before it became a crisis. So moving over to City Hall and taking this job, that was really where sort of I threw my energy and efforts. And when I was invited to present, I thought, you know, where has there been a case where the use of data and our commitment to evidence-based practice really illustrates how the shared vision of these of the agencies working together was facilitated, perhaps made possible in a way that the collaborative work wouldn't have been as successful. And the juvenile justice reform, I think, is a great example, partly because it was how bad it was when we started. So here's here's the situation that we began with. For young people that went into the juvenile justice system, placement in, for those who aren't familiar in the justice world, placement is what is called incarceration for youth. So going into placement, meaning that they are actually behind locked doors, not bars always, but behind locked doors. 70% of the New York young men, mostly from New York City, going into placement, readmitted. So that doesn't mean reoffend or rearrest. It means convicted and replaced within 2 years. I mean, it's hard to get worse than that, right? But wait, look out 10 years, 89% readmitted within 10 years. So basically you have the situation that you know that if you go into placement, it is basically a life sentence to a year, to a life of incarceration. Over 10 years, remember, now you've moved out of the juvenile justice system, you're going into the adult justice system, and the ties to the justice system are just getting stronger and stronger and stronger. And so what we wanted to do as a group of city agencies and state agencies and court officials was to change this. We wanted to pull these kids out of their contact with the justice system to get them as far away from placement as possible and to improve their life chances, to interrupt, you know, so they've made a mistake, they've got a stumble, let's interrupt it as quickly as possible before it leads to these results. And so so this was hard work. So here's, I'm like, oh, this is a fun new job, I'll pull everybody together, we all believe in the same thing, it's gonna be great. So I said, come on, everybody, come to the table. So the first meeting, we had the family court judges, we had the prosecutors, we had the defense lawyers, we had the detention agency and the placement agency, and we had the one little alternative to incarceration program agency. So we had everybody at the table. I said, well, let's get started by talking about what it is. everybody, you know, bring whatever data that you have. What started to become crystal clear is, number one, like, even though all of these individuals knew that they were part of an assembly line process that was moving a kid through the justice system, and starting with police who were also at the table, nobody acted in unison as a single process. They would just, you know, it was like, you know, maybe by coincidence they had some relationships, but for the most part it was just faceless officials handing the case forward and forward and forward down the process. When they came to the table, most agencies didn't really have good data about what they had a lot of process data. Here's how many incoming we have, you know, here's our caseloads, but they didn't have information about the young people and how the young people were doing. And so it was either non-existent or it was non-translatable, meaning that I come with, you know, well, I track for the last 30 days. Well, I track for the last 6 months. I track for 2 years. I track, you know, and everybody had different definitions, different time frames. So even those who had data, it didn't talk to each other. And so that was, so if you want to start to think about, you know, what's the dynamic of the number, the young people that we serve, it was impossible to really get a clear story out of that mess. The clear story that came out was that it was a mess and that there wasn't that kind of, so it wasn't, they weren't acting as partners or collaborators in a shared mission, and they didn't have data that helped them to understand their relationship to each other or the outcome from the kids. And so as a result, all we had, the chart that I showed you, the last slide, that was a one-time study done like 10 years ago by some academic researchers, and that's it. So that data was not refreshed. I don't know, so I give you that data, but I can't tell you today, we're getting closer to this, but I can't tell you today how much that condition has improved or gotten worse, right? So weak outcome data from one-time studies. And then, now you guys will know this. I know I'm a, you know, so I'm the odd man out here. I'm from government, you know, fill out your form and send it to me, right? And so we did, we collected, you know, tons and tons and tons of information, but very little feedback. And sometimes it was coming in and nobody was doing anything with it. And as a result, everybody was no wiser. Everybody, whether it be the government managers or the advocates or the providers that are along the assembly line of service, nobody really knew about how well or how poorly they were doing, and so their ability to actually influence those outcomes was very limited. So we really pushed this. So turning the ship around, this is a metaphor. When I was in child welfare, we had a consultant that worked with us, and he came in and he said, you know, this is like turning the ship around, and it's like the Titanic, and it's gonna, and deck chairs are gonna go flying, and not all deck chairs are gonna remain on deck, and some people are gonna go overboard. And I'm like, oh God, I was afraid I was gonna be one of those that went flying overboard and nobody pulled me back in, right? And so what it really, to me, is held on to as that metaphor is that, you know, these kind of transformational changes can be really messy. And you're rocking a lot of people's boats. I'm gonna keep up with the water theme here. And not everybody likes it, and it can be really, really disruptive. And so the first and most important thing to me that is key, that I believe we never would have gotten anywhere with this work without doing this, is you really had to get all these players united around a shared vision. And this sounds, you know, very sort of simple and no-brainer, but we had a situation where everybody comes to the table, police are there, police see anybody who's trying to release a kid that they've just arrested as undermining them, undermining their authority, undermining their commitment to public safety. You know, why are you having this conversation about keeping kids out? We just like rounded up the offenders and got them in to make our city safe. You know, you're getting on my turf. You're violating my goal. On the other hand, a lot of the agencies, although they sort of professed a commitment to alternatives, they really didn't have the tools and the practices in order to know whether or not the alternatives could work. And so I'm gonna talk a little bit about that, and as I often say, everything I learned in child welfare, and it's just the same story over and over again. But what was really key was to start with trust, and to have the police department and the prosecutors, the defense attorneys, and the folks that were running the placement programs and everything, to understand that we had a shared goal about, and this we were very explicit, it was about public safety, that nothing that we would do would undermine public safety, but that we also believe that there were safe alternatives to bring down the number of young people going into juvenile placement, and that we could succeed in doing that based on a shared conversation about best practices and approaches. And I think that if we didn't start with that, that everything that followed would have been, you know, sort of like this passive aggressive behavior of people around the table. They would have like nodded in the meeting, but then gone out and like ignored the decisions and the conversation. So really being very upfront and honest and having that explicit conversation was really critical. Not only bringing folks together in, from the get-go, but what we actually wound up doing was meeting as a group. Now, this is a large group of people. I had the commissioners of all the agencies. And as a group, we would meet every 8 weeks, and then the different subgroups would meet routinely in between. But the important thing is, because there's lots of glitches, stuff goes wrong, you make mistakes, and having people continually come back and back and back and then work in between meetings was really critical for keeping those, you know, those places where things get caught and could you could stumble on, for raising them to the surface and make sure they got discussed and addressed. Now this is, you know, it's kind of a no-brainer, but it took us a good 9 months to get everybody working on the same definitions and collecting data and reporting it in the same way. And what we actually did, now everyone, there were people are so territorial about their data. We actually said, no, we don't want you all to bring your own data packs. We want you to send it into Wendy. Wendy's going to put it all in one PowerPoint presentation. She's going to guide the conversation, and you're each going to add in. I'm not sending her my data, you know? It's just like people are very, very territorial about their data. So it was a lot of getting the data to talk to each other, but then having it tell that single story about what the experience of young people were in the system. Now here, evidence-based practice, now this is interesting, and I'll come back to it again, but evidence-based practice was incredibly important for this conversation because of the risk that the professionals felt that they were bearing in the system. So I'm a family court judge. I've got this kid who's just committed a crime before me, guilty. And I basically, at that point, when we began this work, there was two options. You either let them go back to the community, or you put them in placement. We had very, very weak alternatives. There was one alternative program that everybody was happy to have an alternative, because, you know, I can't send this kid back to the community. What nobody would talk about and everybody understood is that the alternative was awful. It was a bad program. Our probation commissioner actually called everybody on this one, and he canceled it without notice. He said, it's bad. It's producing bad outcomes. It's not working. I'm canceling the program. All hell broke loose, right? But this was as we were having this conversation. And so what we did was two things that were very important. One is that we created risk assessment instruments. And so nobody ever knew. Like, I had my instinct. I'm a family court judge for 10, 15 years. I know a good kid from a bad kid, right? And so they were working on their instincts and their knowledge about cases, and of course with the recommendations of other professionals, but ultimately that's what people were doing. They were working on instincts. There had been no validated risk assessment instrument. So the first thing we did is we actually created one. We worked with the Vera Institute of Justice, created this risk assessment instrument, and it basically said, is this a kid who you're safe if you send him home? Because, you know, while his crime was a little on the tough side, he's got all of these resources, and he's not going to run away on you. He's going to be back for trial. Versus, on the other end, you know, that's a kid that's, you know, maybe the crime was not so bad, but that's a high risk of flight. This kid's, he's in foster care. He's been AWOLing all over the place. We're going to lose him. And so a risk assessment instrument validated with all of our partners that everybody had confidence in as a valid tool. The second thing, and this is perhaps the, you know, obviously risk assessment isn't useful unless you know what to do then as a result of where a kid falls. We built an entire continuum of services that provide the grid. Our risk assessment instrument, of course, is not just three simple boxes. You have, you know, three across and three up and down, and then you have a special category. So it's a grid, and basically for every kid, and this we could provide the face sheet immediately when a kid was arrested. There was a service that was an appropriate match to that young person. And so we risk assessment instrument, and we built an array of services. Now, evidence-based services. And so we studied the world, and we looked for the most promising things, and we looked for the programs that had evidence and research of what worked. And so our heavy, heavy bias was to find things where there was evidence of what worked. At the same time, we valued innovation. And so we also filled in some of the holes where the evidence was weak and tried out new things with a commitment to do evaluation of those components as we went around, went along to see how they test, you know, are these kids actually doing well in these programs? Are they not reoffending? Are they not absconding? How are they working? So evidence-based practice, confidence of the decision makers that if I put this young person in that program, instead of putting them in detention or placement, that I am not gonna see them out and reoffending in the community, increasing risk to the community. I'm gonna see them safely engaged at home, and this was really, now you wanna go back to that original shared vision, and we're gonna get these kids off the path to a life of incarceration that many, you know, many statistics would say is exactly what they're on. And so better for the kids, better for the community. If we didn't have that validated risk assessment instrument and this continuum of evidence-based programs, then the instinct of the prosecutors and the judges would be, I'm gonna continue to lock them up. It's actually very interesting what happened. This shows some of the progress that we've made. So you can see that we've cut both detention by 43%. That's during the trial stage. So, you know, getting close to a 50% drop in the number of kids that are held in detention pending the outcome of their trial. And this is just a subgroup, non-secure placements. This is the piece where the city now manages. Another whole piece that I won't talk to you about is we actually took over placement responsibility from the state. It used to be if you were placed, you were sent across, you know, the four corners of New York State, far from home. What we said is we want these kids close to home. So Mayor Bloomberg worked hard to get legislation passed to allow any kid that gets placed to stay within the four corners of New York City. And so placement now occurs closer to home. When you look at, this is just non-secure, that's the only piece we have so far. We're about to take over limited secure, and which will then get us most of the kids. Secure will stay with the state. When you look at all the placements combined, we're 60% drop in the number of kids in placement. So this is just a huge, huge I almost feel like it's a miracle, but a tremendous success. The really, really interesting thing that happened is we looked at the results for low, medium, and high-risk kids. Low-risk kids, the grid says they get nothing. You know, they don't need services. They just need their parents to, you know, to give them a good spanking and put them on, you know. What do you do when you don't put your kids, I'm not a parent, right? It's like, oh, no, I am a parent, but, you know, Leo, you're in detention. yeah, he's grounded, right? You need to ground him, and I know we're not supposed to spank kids. I know that. I've never spanked my kid. But that's what the low-risk kids needed. It's the medium-risk kids that really needed the service. So that range of alternatives, they went to the medium-risk kids. The high-risk kids needed detention and placement. And another part of the story that we won't go into is the reforms to what happens when you're in placement in order to produce better results for those kids as well. Really interesting. Every single category of child had lower reoffense rates. The low-risk kids, huge drop in services, less reoffending. So this is where the criminogenic effect of the justice system comes in. They actually sort of got, you know, sort of corralled in with a lot of kids that were much more problematic than them, and they learned those behaviors. They learned the reoffending behaviors. Medium-risk kids also went down because we really targeted our services on those kids to keep them in the community, and they got the supports that they needed. And then the high-risk kids, their reoffending went down because they were behind bars. So this overall decline comes with those nuances that, again, grew out of having the risk-based assessment and the alternatives to placement. Okay, so here we have 5 minutes left. And I've got sort of some observations about, you know, what can go wrong. And this is now sort of like out of this lesson, some generic observations, and then some sort of final reflections. The first thing people will say, when we tried to evaluate our child protective, our child welfare agencies, they said, oh, you can't use that data, it's all wrong. You can't grade us based on the data because, you know, there's data entry errors and quite frankly, nobody wasn't getting used, so people weren't paying attention to it. So that people will object, you cannot use the data. The data's dirty, it needs to be cleaned up. You have to hire 6,000 people and they have to work for 10 years before it's gonna be good enough to use. I reject that. The data will get clean like this with nobody if you say we're using it. And suddenly, and that's in fact, you know, I think that there are ways of transitioning. And so back on child welfare, we actually used the data for 2 years before we actually graded our agencies based on that data, but we put out the reports. So I would say, don't let anybody delay use of data because they say it isn't clean, because you're not gonna get it into that good shape until you really start using it. You know, the challenge of, and this is still the challenge of feedback silence, and I think there's a related challenge here of academic researchers that you really can't have anything evidence-based unless it's subject to a random controlled trial, and 20 years later, I'll tell you whether or not it worked. I mean, that's also a huge pitfall of this work. I believe in random controlled trials, but it shouldn't be the only form of evaluation. And my lesson was that we really needed to work hard, not to just bring the data in to analyze it for ourselves and make ourselves smarter, but the quicker we could turn it around and put it out to people so that all of the participants in the system could see, oh, this is what my court roster looks like. You know, who knew that the judges in Queens had twice as long length of court case processing as the judges in Brooklyn? And you give that to them and ooh, you wanna see an interesting conversation. So really work hard on getting feedback going. Zero sum game, this goes back to the shared vision. Until the police department and the prosecutors came to those initial meetings basically looking to shut us down. They thought we were trouble walking, right? All our hard work to make this city safe and you guys are just gonna undermine it. And so they saw it as a zero-sum game. And getting to that discussion about the shared vision really was it doesn't have to be a zero-sum game. These interventions actually make the city safer, less reoffending across all these categories. So how can you get, move off of turf and get to a shared vision and so it's not a zero-sum game. Here's really hard with the data and where the data can start, can start sending you wrong. It's like, I've done this, I have to say, if you focus on too many things and if those outcomes are not tied to your core vision, then you're gonna send people chasing around improving numbers that really don't matter. And so really trying to work hard to get at what are the really key outcomes and then let's chase those top five instead of, well, here's 50 things the regulations say everybody has to do, and everything is equally important because the feds might come and audit us, and so we have to track all 50. No, you really gotta say, what's the core goal, and really put the emphasis on those. All right, now I know I'm in a room of funders, and it's been really interesting from government. I always wanted to figure out how to get your money, so it's been interesting being inside your brain a little bit. But I've also seen this, where funders come along and they have a very particular goal. And I wanna do this, and I'm here because I hear, you're a great place to work, or I'm here because, your outcomes really stink, you're the place that has to work on this. And it can wind up taking you off track. And so I bring the funding conversation and our partnership with philanthropy really back to that first point around shared vision, and say, this is our shared vision, this is where we're going, be at the table, be part of it. But if we don't get where you want us to be, then you're not the right partner for us. And be willing to acknowledge that because you don't want to get yourself off course. And then the last two, losing soul. I think sometimes we can, the data can become the god and we lose focus on what we're really trying to do, which is to help the lives of these young people that we're serving. And so, just remember, don't let the data become the god. The data is really helping us to understand whether or not we are achieving the goals. And I think the question about leaving room for innovation, the world of evidence-based practice can get a little too crazy. And we can't do anything that's not evidence-based. Well, the reason that you have evidence-based programs is that somebody thought up some idea and said, let's evaluate it. And then the evaluation says, hey, it works, and now it's evidence-based. So where is the room for the new ideas, and how can you actually, in this goal of having an evidence-based practice, make room for that? And to me, the way to make room for that is just to say, try out crazy new ideas, just make sure you evaluate them, and be honest if they fail, and cut them off if they don't work. You know, it's just like, that's the best way to encourage continued evaluation and continued innovation. Okay, so my 30 seconds on lessons, I think are pretty clear. For government, and this is, we can be the big monster in the room, we can snuff out so many voices, we can forget the amount of power that we have. And so I think what's really important for government is we do need to provide leadership and vision, and it can be hard to keep it contained, and so develop manageable set of outcomes and real-time feedback. For the nonprofits, be part of the team. You know, the nonprofits are the generators of all of the new ideas that we need to integrate, and they're the critical providers of that whole continuum of service. And so we rely on both that manpower and that expertise, but also nonprofits can sometimes be unwilling to sort of get under the umbrella. I got my thing, that's what I do in my community. It's, that can be destructive, and that can work at counter purposes, and it can, you know, fail to serve in the best way. So also be part of the team. For foundations, this has made so much of our work critical. This continuum of services that we introduced in the juvenile justice system was funded in a public-private partnership with nonprofits under our Young Men's Initiative. And so that important jumpstart money they bring to the table, you bring to the table incredible ideas, so that role of inspiring and supporting and looking for those leverage points for greater system change. And so, hey, I'm glad to fund your alternative, but I want to know if it works. Will 3 years down the line, will you give a commitment to continue the funding? And so really, maybe being a little tougher on looking for those responses later, instead of getting 3 years later and saying, oh, we have no money, now what are we gonna do? And then for academics and researchers, and they make us smart, they really are thoughtful, they bring best practices in terms of evaluation style techniques, but really urging, you know, we work in the real world of real people, we don't have time always, 15 years, 20 years to wait for results. So try to, you know, sort of really trying to make those practices more of a real-time feedback as well, as they sort of also keeping us honest around whether or not the things that we're doing are actually working. And so this is, so I'm a big fan. I'm a huge, huge, huge fan of metrics. It goes back to the beginning. In God we trust, everybody else bring charts, bring data. I think we need to be honest with ourselves about whether things are working and look hard at the work that we're doing, but it's all in the service of achieving these goals about improving services for the people that we serve. So thank you.